It's great to be here. Today we're going to be talking about APIs, microservices, and Kong. And when we talk about Kong, we'll also have to talk about Apache Cassandra and Scylla, of course. My name is Marco Palladino. I'm the co-founder and CTO of Kong. The industry has been changing very rapidly in the past few years. And the way we build our software has also been changing. We've been transitioning away from one large code base, the monolith, to distributed services. API management, the way we know it, is dead. It's outdated. It's a concept that was born 10 years ago, around 2007, 2008, when mobile application first came out. That sort of API management didn't go away, but has been outdated now that we're building software in different ways, in different architectures. There are primarily three reasons why this is happening. The first reason is that data, it's always in motion. As we are decoupling our monolithic applications in different components, services, microservices perhaps, our data, it's not being handled in a pool anymore, but it's in flight. It goes from one service to another service. It's moving across our architecture. Therefore, our applications are becoming distributed, decoupled. Microservices is not just a technical transition. It's also an organizational and cultural transition. Our teams are also becoming distributed and decoupled. The entire organization is transforming to support this new way of building software. And we are running our applications pretty much everywhere. We are running in a hybrid world. Different systems, perhaps even different clouds, in multiple regions. The way we run our software has also been changing. And if you're familiar with the CNCF landscape, the Cloud Native Computing Foundation, and we look at that landscape, 5 years ago, half of those logos did not exist. How we build our software, how we manage it, how we deploy it, how we monitor it, how we observe all of this different information moving in flight from one service to another, all of that that we were giving for granted with the monolith had to be reinvented for microservices. We're seeing that there is an increase of adoption in microservices around 2013, 2014. Do you know why it happens around that time? Docker was released in 2013, Kubernetes in 2014, and then we all know what happened after that. A new ecosystem has been emerging around these new platforms. Microservices, by any means, they're not invented in 2013 and 14. There are some companies, some organizations, think of Amazon, think of Netflix, think of Google, that transitioned to microservices a long time before. In order to do that, they had to reinvent the entire tooling and, you know, platforms to run those microservices. Now, what's happening in 2013 and 14 is that now we have self-service platforms and ecosystems that everybody else, not just the big ones, but everybody else can now use and adopt. API management was primarily born the way we know it around 2007, 2008, when we had to connect our mobile applications with our monolith via an API, of course. But as we decouple our monolith, as we blow the monolith up into different services, the role of APIs is also changing. It's not the traditional external on the edge use case anymore, but it becomes increasingly internal. Among this transformation of APIs, of systems, of microservices, we're also seeing another trend, which is the hybrid world. It doesn't matter how we build our software anymore. It doesn't matter if it's in Java, if it's in .NET, PHP, Python. It can be anything, as long as we have an interface that we can use to consume it, to communicate with it. This industry is very tribal. It's either my programming language or yours. It's either my platform or yours. That, it's slowly changing. The programming language doesn't matter anymore, as long as I have an interface. And the architecture itself, monolith, microservices, perhaps even serverlets, doesn't matter anymore. We're going to be using whatever architecture it's more convenient for the business case we're trying to fix. And so when it comes to our architectures, we've been going through a journey. Monolith, then different systems, different services, mini services, to connect them together, belonging to different teams, different products, different business units. Microservices, so an increase of adoption in east-west traffic, perhaps even serverless, and who knows what's gonna happen 5 years from now. Again, it's hybrid. It's not going to be one or another. It's going to be all of them together, depending what kind of business case, business requirement we have. This landscape is changing how we run APIs. You know, when Amazon in 2006, 2005 transitioned to microservices, the reason was driven by the actual business. Amazon was selling books, and they had to move to a place where they were selling everything else. The architecture changed as a result to that business case. So depending what kind of business case, business requirement we have, are we trying to scale our system, or are we trying to find product market fit? Depending on what we're trying to achieve, we might explore one or another use case. It's not going to be just one, it's going to be all of them together. So with Kong, and today I'm gonna show you a very quick demo on the terminal. With Kong, we're trying to get a sense of all of these moving parts. So as we build our software in different ways, as we build our software in different architectural patterns, we are going to provide a control plane that helps us getting business value out of that architecture. At the end of the day, we choose an architecture as a driver for our business, and so whatever architecture we're choosing, we need to have the right platform and tooling in place to reconnect the dots to the actual business, right? So as we are transitioning, what information is flowing from one place to another? How do we connect it? How do we extend it? How do we protect it? And this is what Kong is about. Kong, it's an open source product, open core. We're seeing that open source, it's becoming the keyword of this new way of building software. All the most relevant and important technologies nowadays are open source or open core. If you think about Docker, if you think about Kubernetes, if you think about even, you know, Cassandra, Kong, it's open source. Open source is driving this bottom-up adoption within our organizations, which is great in my opinion. Open source has a few fundamental benefits. One of them is that open source, in order to be successful, has to have a very large adoption at the top of the funnel, right? And in order to get that adoption, open source must be easy to use, and must fix and solve a real problem. If it wasn't easy to use, or if it didn't solve a real problem, open source, an open source project wouldn't exist. So open source and modern open source that's being adopted in the enterprise, it's a great thing for the industry, in my opinion. So Kong, it's open source, built on top of Nginx. It's the most widely adopted open source API gateway for north-south traffic, for east-west traffic within your microservice organization. It has a global adoption all over the world. It's available on GitHub. You can download and install it today. $45 million downloads. Kong was born in 2015 from another company called Mashape. Mashape was an API marketplace. So I was the CTO and co-founder of Mashape before Kong. Then with Mashape, we were having a very strong user adoption. It was a place for developers to either publish or consume APIs. It was an API marketplace. And Kong was the underlying technology powering the marketplace. So in 2015, we decided that the marketplace was not going anywhere. And so we pivoted. And so when we looked at our technology that was powering the marketplace under the hood, we decided perhaps that was a good idea to open source. And so that's how Kong was born. Kong was the technology powering the API marketplace, 300,000 developers consuming and publishing APIs. And then since 2015, Kong was adopted, and we decided to get rid of the marketplace and make Kong our main business. Now, today we're gonna see how we're going to use Kong with Scylla, Apache Cassandra. Kong supports two different data stores. The way Kong works, it's very simple, especially for north-south traffic. We have our APIs that can be consumed externally by mobile apps, by developers. We have a cluster of Kong nodes on the execution path of our API requests. And every time a client, can be internal, can be external, wants to consume one of those APIs, it doesn't consume the APIs directly. It goes through Kong first, and then Kong will reverse proxy that request to the final API. Kong doesn't just implement routing, health checks, circuit breaking, and all of those networking, low-level networking features, but Kong also has the concept of plugins. Plugins are middleware functions that we can apply on top of the execution path of our system. So for example, authentication, security, traffic control, logging, monitoring, all of those plugins that are open source, by the way, can be applied on top of the execution path on top of any API. And Kong does that very efficiently because Kong itself, it's built on top of Nginx. So we have extended Nginx with this support for plugins by using a framework called OpenResty. How many of you know OpenResty? And how many of you guys are using Kong today? And how many of you are using Nginx? That's great. So if you're using Nginx, Kong is built on top of Nginx. You can remove Nginx, put Kong. Now you have the power of Nginx, and on top of that, you have access to a full cycle API management product. And so we built Kong on top of Nginx to leverage the very fast and quick Nginx runtime. And then on top of that, we've built support for plugins. We support two different data stores. We support Apache Cassandra, and we support Postgres for storing all the configuration, the routing configuration, for storing the plugins configuration, the credentials within the system. Different data stores for different use cases. Postgres, we usually recommend it for single data center clusters. And Cassandra, as you all know, for eventually consistent distributed Kong clusters. Basically, Cassandra will propagate the routing configuration, the credentials, the plugin configuration across any region or data center or cloud that's connected via Cassandra. So we're leveraging the underlying Cassandra for the replication functions. The way it works, very simple. We have different clients consuming through Kong. This is for the traditional API management use case. Each Kong node is stateless. We can scale Kong up and down by adding or removing Kong nodes. As long as every Kong node communicates with the same Cassandra key space, then we're good to go. Now, we are working with the Scylla team to make Kong compatible with Scylla as well. It's currently in an experimental phase. One of the reasons being Kong is leveraging lightweight transactions that Scylla doesn't support yet. So we're working on two different tracks. Number one, we're implementing a way for Kong to disable those lightweight transactions. We need lightweight transactions because if we are inserting, for example, an API or a plugin from multiple Kong nodes in the same table, we want to be able to avoid a conflict. And so lightweight transactions are used for that specific use case. There's going to be a way to disable those lightweight transactions and use Scylla 3.0 today. But also we're working with the Scylla team to make sure that Kong works with a future lightweight transactions feature. So let's run Kong and let's see a very simple demo. For my demo, I need a simple API. In this case, it's going to be httpbin.org. If you are not familiar with httpbin.org, this is a very simple cloud service. It's a cloud API. You can access it anywhere. And it offers a few HTTP endpoints that, for example, the /get endpoint echoes back the request we're making. So it's great for debugging what's happening within our system. All right, so I'm going to fire up my terminal. I hope you can see it. So right now, I'm running an empty cluster. One of the first things I'm going to do is to tell Kong to start up and execute migrations. So migrations allow Kong, it's only required the first time we run the Kong cluster. It's required to create the key space and to create the first tables. So if I do this, we're seeing that we are migrating our schema, and now if I describe the key space, I see that I have a Kong key space. So what Kong does, it's creating a few tables that we're going to use as we operate the system. Like in the case of if we decide to use OAuth, OAuth tokens, plugins, routing information, and so on. All right. We can now start Kong. Oh, seems like it's already starting. It's already running. Let me double check. All right. So when we start Kong, Kong by default listens on two different ports. One, it's port 8000. Port 8000, it's the port that clients will use to consume any API that's behind Kong. So this is the proxy port, the reverse proxy port. And then there is another port called 8001. Port 8001, it's the admin API of Kong. So this allows us to configure the system by using an admin API. It doesn't matter if we have one Kong node or 100 Kong nodes. We can use the admin API on each one of these Kong nodes. And what the admin API will do will provision any entity we want to create in the underlying Cassandra or Scylla key space. So to use the admin API, very simple. I can make a post request. and I can create a new service in Kong that will point to httpbin.org. Now that I have a service with Kong, I can create what we call Kong routes. A Kong route, it's an ingress route that tells Kong, okay, every request on this specific path, URI, on this specific host header, with this specific HTTP method, should be connected with this service. So it's an ingress, it's a virtual endpoint that we're creating in Kong. For example, I can create a virtual endpoint that will listen on slash test. And now that we have a service, now that we have a route, I can make a request on the proxy port of Kong, slash test, slash get, to consume that route behind Kong. Assuming the internet connection works. Typical demo. Let me see why this is not working. All right. It hanged for a second. So this is a request to our httpbin.org API through Kong. So what Kong will do will recognize our mapping, our virtual endpoint slash test, and then it will append whatever else we're sending to Kong. It's very simple. This is a reverse proxy. Now, on top of this, we can apply Kong plugins. So there are plugins for pretty much any use case. There are authentication plugins. There are security plugins. There are traffic control plugins, ACL, rate limiting, canary releases, proxy caching, and so on. We officially support 60-plus plugins on our plugin hub. So once you have your APIs connected via Kong, we can also add any of these plugins on top of the API in Kong, and automatically we have these additional features on top. Or the community, you know, Kong, it's extensible. The community has also created more than 500 plugins that we can also apply on top of our system. And of course, any organization, any user can also create their own plugins on top of Kong. Think of dealing with a specific legacy authentication system that you're running within the organization. So for this quick demo, I'm going to apply a key authentication plugin. So I want to protect my API with an API key. So what we're going to do is to use the admin API on port 8001, services, httpbin/plugins, and apply the key authentication plugin on top of my service. So that's it. Now I have a plugin installed. If I consume my API again, this time the plugin will be applied dynamically at runtime, and we're seeing that the request doesn't work. So we're going via Kong to also create a new consumer, and all of this information is being stored in the underlying Cassandra cluster. So for example, I can create my a consumer called demo. This is going to be my user. And on top of this consumer, I'm going to create a key, and the key can be, for example, secret 123. Now that I have this, I can go ahead and consume again my API by adding the API key, and Kong will validate the consumer, will validate the key, and proxy the request. All of this, it's of course being stored within the system. So if I search the services, we're seeing that we have our HTTP bin service. This is in the underlying Cassandra cluster. It's a very simple demo. Thank you very much.